Welcome back to the social class, students. This is your third video of lesson number 5, Educational Development in India. So we have to start from modern system of education. The beginning of the modern system of Indian education can be traced to the efforts of the Christian missionaries who arrived in India in the wake of European occupation. So during the Christian missionary, they arrived. Okay, they started Indian education over here. Okay, so in the beginning of modern system, so Indian education was traced on the effort of whom? Christian missionaries. Okay, when they arrived in India, they started the European occupations. Okay, as a result of their efforts, many institutions were established across India. So they took more efforts in order to bring up their European education over here, and they started many institutions in order to establish this educational system in India. So these institutions imparted Western as well as Indian education. So they introduced Western education as well as already the Indian education was there. Next, role of Christian missionaries. So this is the picture of Francis Xavier. Europeans came to India for trade and established trading companies. So when European came to India, they established many companies, trading companies, because they came for trading purpose. Okay, they acquired lands and constructed fortresses. So they started to acquire many lands, they started to purchase many lands, and they constructed fortresses for them. So fortresses is nothing but fort. Okay, so fort is nothing but kota in Tamil, right? Okay, later they wanted to spread their culture and religion among Indians. So after the construction of fortresses and acquiring many lands, they wanted to spread their culture and religion among the Indian peoples. The Europeans thought that they could make Indian understand the administration and the religious theories better if they could impart education to the local population in their own method. So they wanted to spread their religion as well as culture among Indians. So they thought that these Indians could understand through the education. Okay, so they wanted to spread the religion as well as culture through theories of religious theories in order to make the Indians understand more better. Okay, so they started educational institutions. So because of that, they started many educational institutions. The Portuguese were the first Europeans who started modern system of education in India. So education system was started by Portuguese for the first time in India. Okay, so Portuguese were the first Europeans, okay, who started modern system of education in India. So Francis Xavier, so he was a Jesuit, so he started a university at Cochin. So Francis Xavier, you can see the picture in this slide. So he only started the university at Cochin first. They started many primary schools. The first college offering degrees on a completion of a course was started in Goa in 1575, where Christianity, logic, grammar and music were taught. So in Goa, in the year 1575, they taught Christianity. They taught about Christianity, logic, grammar and music. Okay, so John Kirander was one of the most zealous pioneers and was perhaps the first missionary in India to introduce education for non-Christian children as an evangelistic agency. So John Kirander, he was the first important pioneers, and he was the first missionary in India also. Okay, he introduced an education for non-Christian children also, and as an evangelistic agency. So he worked as an evangelistic agency. In the year 1812, Dr. C.S. John, he established 20 free reading schools in Tranquebar. So Tranquebar is nothing but Tarangambadi. You say Tarangambadi, right, in Tamil. So Dr. C.S. John, he introduced 20 free reading schools in which place? In Tranquebar. Next, followed by the Portuguese, the French opened their institutions for all the Indians, where education was imparted by Indian teachers through local languages. so followed by the Portuguese. Even French people, they opened many educational institutions for all the Indians, and they wanted to impart in the local language where the Indians could understand education in a better way. Okay, they started higher secondary education, so school where French languages were taught. So they started higher secondary education. In that higher secondary education, they taught which language? French language. Two Germany bishops named Zingerbalg and Plutschem. So they started schools and a training college for teachers in Travancore. So after the arrival of English East India Company in the 1600 AD, institutions were established for imparting instruction is in English. They wanted to spread the education through the English language. Gradually, Sanskrit college were opened in Madras and Banaras. So slowly, they opened a college in Sanskrit. So in the place called Banaras and Madras. The first bishop of Calcutta, the Revered Dr. Middleton, started a missionary college at Calcutta, which became famous as the Bishop's College. So Bishop of Calcutta, okay, his name was Dr. Middleton. He started a missionary college at Calcutta, okay, and that was a famous college of Bishop's College, okay. Mount Stuart Elphinstone was actually a strong advocate of vernacular education, but on his retirement in the year 1827, his admirers collected funds and established a college offering English classes named the Elphinstone College at Bombay. So there was a person called Mount Stuart Elphinstone. So he was a strong advocate in his vernacular language. Okay, but on his retirement, when he retired in the year 1827, his admirers, okay, they collected funds from others and they established a college offering English classes, okay, and they named that college as Elphinstone College in Bombay. Okay, missionaries made a good deal of attempt for the propagation of education in India. Due to their efforts, many institutions were established. These institutions imparted Western education as well as Indian education. Okay, next, education and the British rule. So history of education in British rule can be divided into four periods. So how many periods? Four periods. From the early days of British rule up to 1813. Second one is period from 1813 to 1853. Third one, period from 1854 to 1920. And the fourth one was period from 1921 to 1947. So first one, from the early days, so four parts we saw, right? So we are going to see that these four parts in detail now. Okay, from the early days of the British rule up to 1813. During its early days, the East India Company followed a policy of indifference or non-interference towards education, as this sector did not form a part of its program. So during the early days of this year 1813, the East India Company, they followed a policy of indifference, okay, as well as non-interference toward the education, and the sector did not form a part of this program. The company's character was renewed in the year 1813, which compelled the company to assume responsibility for the education of Indians, though on a very limited scale. Besides missionaries, non-missionaries like Raja Ram Mohan Roy of Bengal, Pachiyappar of Madras, W. Fraser of Delhi, they contributed to the course of education. Next, do you know? In the year 1813, the East India Company was compelled to assert the responsibility for the education of the Indians. So in the year 1813, East India Company, it was compelled to the responsibility of education, this Indian education, okay. Charter of Act of 1813, they made a provision for an annual grant of a sum of 1 lakh rupees for the promotion of education in India. Next, second one, period from 1813 to 1853. The second period was also marked by great educational controversies concerning the issues of educational policy
medium of instruction and method of spreading education. So the second period was marked as a great educational controversies. Okay, what they concerned about it? They concerned issue of educational policies, medium of instruction and method of spreading education. Okay, first they were the Orientalists who supported the preservation of Oriental learning and the use of Sanskrit and Persian language as a medium of instruction. They were opposed by the Angelistic who advocated dissemination of Western knowledge through English. A third section believed in the use of Indian language as the media of instruction. These controversies were partially set at rest by Macaulay's Minutes of 1835. Higher education was de-orientalized, encouraging English education for the upper classes. Each provinces was allowed to follow its own education policy, but even then the controversies continued till the year 1854. Third one, period from the year 1854 to 1920. The third phase of British influence education may be called the period of an all India educational policy. So this third period, so this was called as what? Period, All India Educational Policy period. Okay, it commenced with Sir Charles Wood's dispatch in the year 1854. Hunter Education Commission, started in the year 1882, gave emphasis to primary education. The Wood's dispatch in the year 1854 is called the Magna Carta of English education in India, because it was the first declaration of British education policy for educating the masses of all levels, but it resulted in the complete control on state education, divorcing it from Indian deals and culture. And the last one is period from 1921 to 1947. The fourth phase may be called the period of provincial autonomy. The Act of 1935 assured a new era of educational advancement through the country. The new programs were hit hard by the worldwide economic depression in the year 1929. The introduction of complete provincial autonomy by the Government of India Act of 1935 further strengthened the position of the provincial ministers of education. After the Second World War, a very important plan for educational development known as Sargent Report in the year 1944 was prepared. The blueprint had a powerful influence on contemporary education, both in thought as well as in practice. Next comes Wardha Scheme of Education in the year 1937. In the year 1937, Gandhiji evolved a scheme popularly known as the Wardha Scheme of Basic National Education. The principle of non-violence was the basis of Gandhiji's scheme of basic education. Through the scheme, he wanted to develop those qualities in future citizens of India which he considered necessary for building a non-violent society. A system of education wanted to root out exploitation and centralization in society and create a non-violent social order. So next one is map. So this map is important for your exam, which comes for your exam too. Okay, so here they have given various educational centers. Okay, you could see Taxila here, Delhi, Jaipur, Wallaby, Bombay. Here it is Lucknow, Allahabad, Benares, Nalanda, Vikramasila, Calcutta, Wardha, and here in the south you could see Madras, Kanchi, Chidambaram, Srirangam, Tanjore, Madurai, Cochin. Okay, so these were the educational centers in India. Next, educational development of independent India. The new epoch making era in the history of education was assured with the attainment of independence in the year 1947. It brought a new hope, a new vision and new future for the Indians. In the year 1948, Dr. Radhakrishnan Commission was appointed to present a report on university education. In pursuance of the Commission's recommendations, University Grants Commission was constituted to determine the standard of higher education. One of the most important events that have taken place in the field of secondary education was the appointment of Secondary Education Commission in the year 1952 to 53. It suggested new organizational patterns, improvement in quality of textbooks, curriculum and methods of teachings. An education commission under the chairmanship of Dr. D. S. Kothari was appointed by the Government of India in the year 1964. Free and compulsory primary education for all children up to the age of 14 years and uniform education structure of 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern were its main recommendations. National Policy on Education. The first National Educational Policy of 1968 marked a significant step in the history of education in post-independent India. It aimed to promote national progress, a sense of common citizenship and culture, and to strengthen national integration. In the year 1986, the Government of India introduced a new education policy. The aim of new education policy was to transform a static society into a vibrant one with a commitment to development and change. It emphasized on equal opportunities for marginalized sections of the country and the removal of disparity through scholarships, adult education and open university, especially for rural India. The new education policy called for a child-centered approach in primary education and launched Operation Blackboard to improve primary schools nationwide. So you could see in the Do You Know, education remained a state subject. So education remained a state subject till the year 1976 December. But now the education is in the concurrent list. Next. The new education policy was revised again in the year 1992. It envisaged the formulation of the national curriculum framework, emphasis on in-service education, improvement of facilities and streamlining of the evaluation system at the secondary stage. And next is Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, SSA. So this comes in short answer for you. It's very important. SSA. Next one, and Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan, RMSA. So this heading comes in short answer for you, okay? The Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, SSA, is the Government of India's flagship program that was launched in the year 2000 to 2001 to achieve Universal Elementary Education, that is UEE. That is what? Universal Elementary Education, okay? SSA is now the primary vehicle for implementing the provisions of the Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act passed in the year 2009. That is RTE. That is Right to Education. Got it? Right to Education provides for free and compulsory education to all the children from the age of 6 to 14 years. The SSA, what is SSA? Sarva Siksha Abhiyan. Initiates a variety of innovation and activities related to schools. Some important activities include providing the midday meals and stipends for students, the setting up of school management committees, that is SMCs, school management committees, okay, and provision of teaching learning materials for classrooms. Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan, RMSA, is a centrally sponsored scheme for universalization of access and improvement of quality education at the secondary stage. So this is a picture they have given, Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, this education for all. Okay, so which was implemented during 11th 5-year plan period. The goal of RMSA. What is RMSA? Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan. Okay, the goal of Rashtriya Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan is to make secondary education qualitative, available, accessible and affordable to all young students in the age group of 15 to 16 years. So they should have what kind of facilities? Science lab, libraries, okay, in service training for teachers, computer aided education, co-curricular activities and teaching learning aids or provided by the government of India through RMSA scheme at the school level. The union budget of 2018-19 proposed to give school education holistically without segmentation from preschool to class 12. Samagra Siksha, and to be prepared with the broadened goal of improving school effectiveness measured in terms of equal opportunities and equitable learning outcomes. It subsumes the schemes called SSA and RMSA. Okay, in the year 2017, a committee was constituted by the Ministry of Human Resource Development to draft the national education policy. So this committee submitted its report in the year 2019. Next comes educational development in Tamil Nadu. The pattern of education in Tamil Nadu was not merely reading and understanding of books but listening to learned persons. The Thirukkural stresses the need for education and warns the dangers of illiteracy. In ancient times, the school was called Palli and the teacher was called Kanakkayar. Okay? Significant development took place in the field of education during the Pallava periods. Gatika was an educational institution. The Pallava king supported those educational institutions through endowments. The Vaishnava and Saiva mats provided boarding and lodging facilities to all students and teachers. Hoinsang gives a graphic picture about Kanchi Buddhist center, and Kanchi was considered as the main center of learning. The Chola period was the most brilliant and creative period in the Tamil literature. Tamil education enjoyed a greater connection with religion and temple. Free education was given to people. So people got free education during Chola period. The curriculum and syllabi had a theoretical background. From the inscription of that period, we can now gain knowledge about the qualification of teacher, method of teaching, salary of teachers, food provided to the students and the land given to the schools, etc. Raja Raja Chaturvedi Mangalam was the famous seat of a Vedi college. This Ennayiram in former South Orcott districts. Okay, at Thiruvuvanai, which is in Pondicherry, Vedic college flourished. The Thiruvadai Kalai's inscription mentioned a library. Thiruvaduthurai inscription of Veera Rajendra refers to a medical school. So this comes in short answer as well as in detail for you. Okay. Next, the Pandya kings patronized Sanskrit in an exemplary way. It is revealed in the copper plates. The educational institution of that period was called as Gatigai, Salai and Vidya Sadhana. Lands were given to teachers. They were known as Salaboham. Example, Vallabha Perun Salai at Kanyakumari. The famous college during the Pandya regime was Kandular Salai. Mutts occupied a significant place in the promotion of education. Learning flourished under the Vijayanagar rule. Many educational institutions were established under their patronage. Tinnapalli Kudam was established during the Naik rule. Next, coming to education in modern period. Fernandez, who came to Madurai during the time of Veerappa Naik, established a primary school. So Fernandez, when he came to India, to Madurai, okay, during the Veerappa Naik period, so he established what? Primary schools. The Maratha ruler Sarfoji II collected the old records and kept them in Saraswati Mahal library, which is in Tanjore. He also had a printing press with Devanagiri type located there. Sir Thomas Munro, the governor of Madras Presidency from 1820 to 27, was highly responsible for the introduction of Western education in Madras Presidency. This is the picture of Sir Foji II and Sir Thomas Munro. He appointed a committee to conduct a statistical survey of the condition of education. The Education Commission of Munro recommended the creation of two principal schools, Collectorate and Tahsildar schools, in each district. In the year 1835, Lord William Bentinck passed a resolution favoring the introduction of Western system of education in India. Wood's dispatch of 1854 introduced the Department of Public Instruction in Madras Presidency. Grant in aid was given to all schools. The Madras University was founded in the year 1857. It was the first university in Tamil Nadu under the British rule. In 1882, the Local Boards Act was passed. The board was empowered to open new schools and to get grants from the government. By 1938, all subjects except English were taught in Tamil in schools. The Annamalai University was founded at Chidambaram in the year 1929. This was the next step in the development of higher education. So next, coming to education since independence. Free education at the secondary school was introduced in the year 1964 to 65. The Gandhigram Rural College was established in the year 1975. Since 1971, distance education was also been introduced in Tamil Nadu to educate those who could not go to colleges. In 1956, midday meal program was introduced in schools. Later, it was extended as nutrition meal scheme in the year 1982 to avoid dropouts in schools. Since 1986, several changes have taken place to meet the changing dynamics of the society in keeping with the national policy of education. So let's recap the lesson. Education is recognized as the foundation of a progressive society. Indigenous education was imparted at home in temple, pathshala and gurukulas. Medieval period witnessed a radical transformation with the introduction of Muslim education. In the later medieval era, the British came to India and introduced English education. The first national education policy in the year 1968 marked a significant step in the history of education in post-independent India. And last, free education at the secondary school level was introduced in the year 1964 to 65. Okay, children, we have completed this lesson. Mark the question answers and study the question answers carefully. Take care and be safe.